I didn't hear her in making the amendment. I thought she was starting the amendment after the amendment that we made that included the Minister of National Defence. But if she is in fact deleting that, then
I'm thinking the clerk has not got it right.
I don't think you were deleting the are you deleting the phrasing of the Minister of National Defence?
So where is this going?
Okay.
Yeah,
it's after.
After the Minister of National Defence.
Instruct. Yeah, the Minister of National instruct to so, instruct.
So okay, so it would be so. So then it.
So it would be urged instead of them. You would say the employer.
Urge the employer.
Right.
So it's a call on the Minister of National Defence to urge the employer. Is that what? Yeah. Is that where that goes?
I think it would be. Yeah. So then maybe that'll be. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's go at that again.
Point
of order. If I'm. Oh, go ahead.
I'm not confident that this additional amendment is in order because we've already voted on this amendment.
No, we haven't.
Urge versus instruct.
It has to be. If the ruling I made as chair was that there was substantially different than the previous vote on the same phrasing. She started the same phrase. So she's got more, I should say, phrasing in the amendment, and therefore it is in order.
Okay, I'd like to speak to it.
Okay, well, let's make sure that we all know what we're talking about first. Okay, so for the purposes of clarification, I'm going to ask Ms. Lalonde to do it again so that the clerk and the ever-so-humble chair understand what we're talking about.
Oh, my God. Yes, yes, yes. Give me a quick second. I just want to make sure that I... Okay, so we would say, and just indeed, and call on the Minister of National Defence to urge the employer to bargain in good faith and come to a fair resolution.
Okay. Are we clear on that?
I think so.
So, apologies. I have a question from Madame Lalonde. So you're replacing everything then that comes after Minister of National Defence with what you've read? Is that correct? You're deleting to come to the table, bring an end to the strike and bargain in good faith with our civilian military workers with to urge the employer to bargain in good faith and come to a fair resolution. Point.
To bargain in good faith and yes. Yeah. And
you're right, clerk.
Yeah, I think. And come to a fair resolution. Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
We all seem to know what we're talking about here. We're all on the same page. I saw Mr. Kelly's hand up first. Well, I'm sorry. You're right. I apologize. Mr. Fisher was first.
Thank you very much. I just, and I say this to Ms. Matheson, when I heard about this motion, I was super supportive. And as we were, all of us on this side, we were super supportive because we believe that the best deals are made at the table. But asking a minister to interfere with collective bargaining, I think, sets a precedent. What happens if there's a change of government? You've got a government that doesn't believe in collective bargaining. Do you want that minister then sitting down and instructing one way or the other? I think this could potentially be dangerous, and it sets a precedent. I went from being super, super supportive of your motion and the importance of what you were trying to accomplish to... having great concern with the amended and sub-amended motion to the point where I'm not even certain that I can vote for the entire motion now, and that would be really sad because I support exactly what you're trying to do. I just don't support the interference. Having a minister encourage returning to the table, having a minister encourage both sides to come together for a collective bargaining, a fair bargaining agreement, is exactly what I think you want to accomplish. But I honestly feel that having a minister interfere in this is not a good precedent for us to start.
I simply say to Mr. Fisher, he's welcome to vote against it if he doesn't agree with the principle here that that we hold the Minister of National Defense responsible for that which is his responsibility as minister.
Exactly to the point, ministers do instruct the employer within the public service, and there are many things that they can do as part of the negotiations, no matter what it is. I would be sad if everyone didn't support this, but let's be honest, these people have been on strike for 3 months. Things have been quite, they've undergone quite a lot of intimidation. They have not received a lot of respect on the picket line. It has been very, very difficult for already underpaid workers who are doing incredible work. We haven't seen any movement. The minister has already urged or encouraged, and we haven't seen any movement. It is incumbent upon us, as I know we all agree, to push harder. And that's what I'm asking. We can't continue to hope that this will all work out without further pushing and a stronger stance on this. And the workers in those positions deserve that.
Any other debate? Seeing none, is there any other debate?
Can we ask for 2 more minutes suspension?
No.
You don't get to determine, I asked the chair.
No, you know what, Mr. Speaker, and I, you know what? So out of respect for what we're doing here today, actually, I do care. I really care about these workers. And it's interesting that we're debating this while we had a very good solution, and we would have not have waste again a witness time. And it's interesting for me. Can we just suspend for a couple of minutes so we could find language to agree on this motion?
Point of order. I think somebody's got a repetitive lisp here. I will recognize your point of order.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair. My concern about the rules of order, their observance, is whether or not you even gave Madame Lalonde the floor. I didn't see any indication of that.
I asked whether there was any further debate.
That wasn't debate. She wasn't debating the motion. She was asking for a suspension.
And IRA denied the suspension.
Okay, then we move on to whoever is next in debate.
That I have so much help on this committee. It's just amazing.
The rules matter,
it's such
Chair.
A useful...
Chair, the rules matter.
And they do. And I'm adhering to them. Ms. Gallant, would you like to intervene on this rule, a point of order?
I wanted to speak to the motion that was before us.
So we're still on debate then.
The point is that, you know, here we are. We are probably, as a nation, as a world, closer to the edge of war than we have been since Afghanistan. The threat is high from several different angles, and our military has seen the greatest attrition it has in decades, and we are talking about whether or not to instruct the minister to require them to actually negotiate so that the people who are serving the military are actually getting maybe at least a little more above minimum wage. They're taking care of the kids because both parents work. Some of the spouses are having to stay home. So the military guys are, instead of doing what they're supposed to be doing, are taking care of the kids, and they're leaving the military because they just can't afford to live on one income. So let's cut to the chase here and think about what's important overall, why the people need to be supported, get them to the table, get a fair negotiation, a fair wage, and some job security across the board. So let's just get on with this instead of pinching pennies and splitting hairs.
Ms. Lalonde.
Actually, Mr. Speaker, I rarely say this, but Mrs. Gallant's absolutely right in the sense that, you know what, this is a non-binding motion. You know what, we wasted valuable time for our witness, and I know it was part of my responsibility to bring my glasses to work today, but at the same time, we had an agreement on a motion that we collectively, I think, could have all passed. So this is a non-binding motion, and that's fair. Let's proceed.
Okay, any other debate? Call the vote. So that we know what we're calling the vote on, I will defer to my esteemed clerk.
So the question is on the amendment as proposed by Madame Lalonde to remove everything after the words Minister of National Defense with, and I quote, to urge the employer to bargain in good faith and come to a fair resolution, end quote.
Okay. Those in favor of the amendment? Okay. Carried?
No, you asked who's in favor.
Yeah.
I saw one hand up. I don't know.
Well, I thought, in some respects, I was assuming this is a unanimous vote.
No. Hold the vote.
You're voting, we're voting on her sub-amendment, and I oppose her sub-amendment. So if we... Sorry, amendment.
Sorry, I am confused. I apologize.
So, yes. Show of hands.
Show of hands.
On the amendment.
Those in favor of the sub-amendment. Those opposed. Yes. Defeated.
Okay. Now the main motion.
Now we're clear. Yes. Now the motion.
Call them up.
Okay.
So.
Go ahead.
Those in favor. Great.
All right. Any opposed? All right. We've got. We've got 45 minutes left, as I count it. Do we want to complete? We want to complete a second round of questions. And I think where we left off was Ms. Masson finished her 6 minutes, and now we're on to the 5-minute round. And so, Ms. Gallant, 5 minutes.
Chair, is being almost 100. We're going on 100 days of this strike with these different bases. How is it affecting military readiness?
So I cannot answer that question. It's outside of my area of responsibility. What I can say is that all the supports to military families have stayed completely intact because the military family resource centers, which are not employed, which the employees are not staff of the non-public funds, so there has been absolutely no impact to services to military families.
Okay, so I went to the military family services, and they were already full to the brim with a waiting list of people long before this group went on strike. So there is a shortage of daycare, a shortage of many other things. What has this strike cost CFMWS thus far, including flying the managers across the country to fill in the canexes, that sort of thing? How much cost thus far?
Outside of my area of responsibility, I actually have no idea.
Okay, so we've got the 5 or 6 different locals that are being negotiated right now. How many other sets of locals have to be negotiated after this one?
So, again, outside my area of responsibility, I'm not part of our HR department, and I absolutely have no idea.
So is there more than one?
I have no idea.
You have no idea whether or not this is the only handful of
I don't,
locals
because
that whether... Okay. All right. Many of your employees are married to military personnel, so they get posted from base to base as well. So it's my understanding that when they get posted, it's not like they have a job at another base. They start applying for when a job becomes available, but they get no standing whatsoever. So it's like, you know, they'll work their way up, maybe get above a minimum wage over 7 or 8 years, then they're... spouse gets transferred, and they got to start all over at the bottom again at minimum wage. Why isn't there something put blanket-wide so that there's some protection, so that they know that they've got a job or the possibility of a job, or they're not going to lose their income because they don't have a job when the spouse is posted.
So that's exactly why we introduced the Military Spousal Employment Network, to allow for families, military family members, to access employment in advance of a posting. So going to virtual career fairs, going with a career coach, all of those.
Okay. The government's decided to hike the rent on our troops and increase the carbon tax by 20%, 23% all in the same month. Have our military families expressed concern with how they're going to afford these increased costs?
Specific to those two, I don't have any awareness. However, I do know that military families do access support our troops when they are in financial distress. We are also working within CFMWS on financial literacy and financial counseling for military families to help them support, to support themselves as they're moving through the military journey.
So then when the spouses who are employed by your organization are looking, are posted looking for work, it makes a difference as to whether or not that family can even stay in the military if they don't have both incomes. So this is impacting the force strength, which is diminishing by the day. We're losing more soldiers than we're recruiting. Mm-hmm. And here we are in a very critical situation worldwide where we need our troops in force. With respect to the housing, I actually saw, was door knocking on Saturday, and I was in Petawawa, and there were some empty homes. So I looked online to see what they were worth, and they're about $500,000 starting. Now, when you look at an individual who's married and who's a lower rank, How important do you think it is that the employees have that opportunity for the job? But before you answer that, I'd like to have Mr. Bazan ask a question. Okay. So I'm giving my last minute to Mr.
Yeah. Oh, I was going to keep on going.
Keep going.
Okay. I just got it walked in, but thank you, and I want to thank your witness for being here.
I do want to move a motion, though, that I gave notice on Monday for. That's given that January 2023, Canada announced it would donate a National Advanced Surface-to-Air Missile System, NASAM, to Ukraine worth $406 million. On April 11th, 2023, then-Defense Minister Anita Anand said the NASAM was en route to Ukraine, and that the NASAMs have not yet been delivered to Ukraine. Therefore, that the committee invite the Minister of National Defense to provide a briefing on the current status of the NASAM for Ukraine within 14 days. I will speak to that motion. So, as we know, Mr. Chair, Minister Nand made that statement on April 11th, 2023. That was 12 months ago tomorrow. We know that in January 2023, the government promised to send the NASAM to help with air defense in Ukraine. Here we are, 15 months since that time, and Ukraine is fighting for its life. It's reported today that Russian MiG fighters and Sukhoi bombers are flying unimpeded over the conflict area and bombing cities like Kharkiv. And it is unfortunate that we may be witnessing Kharkiv being razed to the ground the same way the Russians pounded Mariupol. This is unconscionable, what the Russians are doing, but it is also an embarrassment for Canada to have promised to provide the defensive weapons that Ukraine needs and have not delivered. So I think that we need to have the minister come before us here to explain why the NASAM hasn't been delivered, where the $406 million has gone, and why the production of, as far as we know and from what we can tell in open source media, is that it's not even getting built. So if we're going to stand with Ukraine, if we're going to ensure their safety and security, if we're going to honour the promises that we make and stand by those promises, then, you know, for the love of God, we have to find out why the NASAM hasn't been delivered. Ukraine is begging for support and help. You know, we suggested back in January by our leader, Pierre Polyev, that we have 83,000 CRV-7 rockets. collecting dust in Dundurn, Saskatchewan, at the CFB base there. Those rockets were requested by Ukraine. And why they haven't been sent yet is beyond me. Those will also help push back the Russian barbarians who are flowing over the borders and occupying and killing Ukrainians and occupying Ukrainian territory. So I believe that all members want to see Ukraine succeed. All members want to see Ukraine save their citizens and push back these Russian invaders. And they can't do that with just empty promises.
So is it en route or not?
So I just ask, Mr. Chair, that we pass this motion, ask the minister to come before committee, give us an update of where we're at with the NASAM delivery, which should be a game changer for Ukraine so that they can protect their skies from things like drones, the Iranian-made kamikaze Syed drones. They can protect their airspace from cruise missiles and cruise missiles and other ballistic missiles that are coming across from Ukraine. And, of course, the Russian fighters and bombers that are now freely flying into their space. Never mind the proliferation of drones that are being used in this as well. And so everything we can do to help Ukraine win this war is not just about the empty promises. It's about being timely. It's about being sincere. It's about being a dependable partner. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rizan. I'll recognize Mr. Collins and then Ms. Gallant and then Ms. Lambropoulos. After I repeat what I said at the beginning of the meeting, it would have been helpful, out of respect for the witnesses and respect for the clerk that does a lot of work to try and put these meetings together, that we went about it in an orderly fashion. However, the committee has chosen to ignore those that injunction. So may I, first of all, let the witness go?
Let her go.
We fine with that? I apologize for the abuse of your time. And I just want to say, colleagues, it's a heck of a lot of work on the part of the clerk to put these meetings together, and we are having difficulties because the witnesses, the potential witnesses, have noticed. So if you want this committee to function in the future, you'll proceed in an orderly fashion. With that, Mr. Collins.
Mr. Chair.
I recognize Mr. Collins.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, that I apologize to the witness. I certainly take what you say into consideration in terms of, I mean, you referenced it at the beginning of the meeting, so I apologize that we're in the situation we're in now, but we are because the motion's been put. So I, you know, that last speech was a little hard to listen to because when it comes to commitment to Ukraine, it was unanimous up until about a year ago. And then, of course, we've seen the party opposite abandon Ukraine. You'll know, Mr. Chair, there was a meeting in Toronto from Ukrainian community. Some of the members opposite were in that meeting where the community talked about the lack of support that they're receiving from the official opposition. Members from the Ukrainian diaspora talked about being used as political pawns, as a wedge issue here in Parliament. And I had to sit through, the leader of the opposition came to Hamilton as part of his Make Canada Great Again tour, and he talked about this, he referenced all the support that the government provided and focused on this one issue, saying we haven't delivered. I have the list of everything in front of me in terms of what has been committed and what's been delivered, and on almost every single issue on this page that I have on the government's website, which is very current if you want to access it at any point in time today, from artillery to field equipment, clothing, infrastructure, individual meal packs, maritime, tanks, the list goes on. Almost every single thing that we've put through our consecutive budgets over the last 2 years since this conflict has started, we've delivered on.
And so, yes, we do have this outstanding issue. But I think it flies in the face of the narrative that was that the picture that was just trying to that the member opposite tried to create here, that the government is not committed. If there is a party in Parliament that is not committed to Ukraine, and of all the days to bring it up, when we pass, we've received word today that the free trade agreement that they voted against was approved today. It's without shame. Like, it's, I couldn't believe the leader of the opposition showed up in Hamilton to speak to the Ukrainian community after he's let them down. That extends to other communities, not just in Hamilton, but around the country. The Polish community, very concerned about what happens next and the lack of support that we're seeing from the official opposition. It is also in addition to the nonsense that we see south of the border in terms of what the Republicans are doing, which is exactly what our friends across the table here are doing as well. And they're trying to wait this out. They're hoping Trump does their dirty work and that they won't be forced to continue to oppose assistance to Ukraine. So it's hard to listen to that in this setting. It's hard to listen to it in Parliament when they talk about their support, when in fact we know it's quite the opposite with the votes. And it's all on public record. And so that's the beauty of the system that we have here. And the Ukrainian community is onto them. The fact they had that meeting in Toronto and had to call them out in a private meeting, which ended up being recorded, I think is proof in point in terms of where the Ukrainian community is. And I thank the other parties for their continued support because it should be unanimous, and unfortunately it isn't. So to the motion, Mr. Chair, I think that the last part of this in terms of within 14 days is unreasonable, and so I would move an amendment to strike that. And I would also seek the committee's concurrence in terms of looking at revising the first part of this in terms of getting an update on what we have approved in our budgets and what has been delivered and what's outstanding. There may be something in addition to what Mr. Bazan has referenced here today in his motion that is outstanding, and I'd like to know what those other items are. But I think telling one side of the story without the other as it relates to what we've invested in terms of supporting Ukraine and highlighting here at the committee when they made their way overseas, have they been utilized, what's outstanding, and of course we have our budget that's going to be released next week, and so we can add to that list. So I'm not going to belabor the point, but I think that we need to at a minimum remove the 14 days, and I would seek to propose an amendment that is all-encompassing, that shows everything that's on the table as it relates to Ukraine support. And then we can have the debate when the minister comes and talk about what parties are there for Ukraine and which ones are not.
Just before I recommend just a lot, within 14 days, a deletion is clearly an order as an amendment. But the overall,
yeah,
it has to be kind of framed for rather than just.
No, we can deal with the 14 days, and I'll come back with wording on the first part.
Okay. So there's an amendment on the floor at this point, but Ms. Gallant has the floor.
I wanted to speak in favor of the motion. About 2.5 weeks ago, I was able to receive briefings together with colleagues from the NATO Parliamentary Assembly. The meeting was in the Baltics. And at that time, we were advised that the observations of troop movements and other actions taken by Putin in Russia indicate that they are planning for a full-scale invasion past Ukraine into parts of Europe. Now, if that happens, the other parts of Europe are NATO members, and we're all well-versed with Article 5. An attack on one is considered an attack on us all. The point being, if we can get this material, these NASAMS and all the other things that we've promised but may not have gotten to Ukraine, into their hands, they can fend them off in Ukraine. If Greater Europe becomes involved, that means our sons and daughters are going to be asked to go and fight. So it's far better to keep the battle area constrained as to where it is right now and give them what they need. And that's why I'm in favor of Mr. Bazan's motion.
Madame Lambropoulos.
Did she speak on the motion of the amendment?
She
You're speaking on debate.
I guess it was more of a point of...
We'll vote on talking about the whole thing. Go ahead, sorry.
It was more of a point of order to let the witness go, but you already did that.
Okay. Mr. Bazant.
So first, Mr. Chair, just want to comment on your statement. We could have had a meeting on Monday. We didn't have any witnesses. We could have dealt with all these motions at that point in time. To go and blame those that are moving these motions from multiple parties today is your job is to direct traffic. It's not there to chastise those of us who have serious issues that we believe that we should be talking about. You know, usually you only have a witness sit at the end of this table for 1 hour, not 2 hours. And to only have one witness show up today, I think is disappointing to say the least, because we have serious studies that we want to do, and we need to have substantive discussions with witnesses on this, and to have only one witness here for 2 hours was not a good use of everyone's time compared to how you usually manage a meeting. As a Ukrainian, I take personal offense with Mr. Collins' comments. For him to get up on his soapbox and try to suggest stuff like that I don't support Ukraine or conservatives don't support Ukraine is playing right into the hands of Putin himself. And so, I think Mr. Collins should take great measure in the words that he uses instead of being hyperpartisan all the time. I can also say this, that one thing liberals have delivered is detonators for Russian landmines. They delivered gas turbines for Russian pipelines to put money into Putin's war machine. They've delivered avionics for Russian drones, Assad kamikaze drones that are being used to kill Ukrainians today. Now, they've delivered all those. I can tell you what they haven't delivered. They haven't delivered the NASAMS, as I said, which were promised back on January 10th. November 24th, 2022, they promised 11,000 assault rifles and machine guns with 9 million rounds of small arms ammunition. Not delivered. They promised September 22nd, 2022, 35 high-resolution drone cameras valued at $76 million. Nowhere in sight. June 10th, 2023, 10,105 artillery ammunition and 257 air defense missiles. Not delivered. September 22nd, 2023, announced Canada will expand its aid by adding 50 more Canadian armored vehicles worth about $480 million from London, Ontario. And I can tell you that JDLS and Armatech have no signed contracts to deliver those armored vehicles. There was $25,000 million worth of winter clothing promised back in October 11th, and 11,000 or 2,000 female uniforms. Not delivered. Guess what? Winter's over. I guess they don't need them now till next winter. They also just promised on October 11th, 76 millimeter naval ammunition, 227 1,000-pound aircraft bombs, 155 artillery smoke rounds, 2,000 mortar smoke rounds, and 22,600 gas masks. These were all promised right after President Zelensky was here. Not delivered. And again, Minister Blair keeps talking about increasing production of 155 artillery shells. We have not increased the production of howitzer shells in this country by one iota. And this war has been going on now for over 2 years. I'm not surprised that Mr. Collins and Liberals want to delay the report from the minister on where the NASAM is at. I'm sure that department officials can give them an update in 14 minutes, not 14 days. And meanwhile, Ukraine sits and languishes with daily attacks upon them by the Russian barbarians. And for us to sit here and say 14 days is too quick, especially knowing that we're only here for this week and next week, and we know that the minister canceled from appearing at committee for supplementary estimates, I believe it is time for him to appear to explain to us why the NASAM hasn't been delivered, and I'm more than happy to go through this litany of stuff that wasn't delivered that right now represents over 60% of the value of promises made to Ukraine and remain unfulfilled.
Mr. Bazant actually did make the point that I wanted to add, because I don't want to prolong this. I hope that we can go to a vote. I'll leave it at that.
There's one amendment that's properly before the committee.
We'll go with that one.
Yep. Okay. Those in favor of the amendment as proposed?
It's to strike the
14 days.
You want to record a division?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Mr. Clerk?
Mr. Fisher?
Support the.
Mr. Fillmore?
In favor.
Madame Lambropoulos?
In favor.
Mr. Collins?
In favor.
Ms. Vandenbelt?
In favor.
Mr. Bazan?
Opposed.
Ms. Crabb-Diamond?
Opposed.
Mr. Kelly?
Opposed.
Ms. Gallant?
Opposed.
Madame Normandin?
Oh.
And Ms. Matheson?
In favor.
So motion amendment passes. Now, do you want to go to the main motion, Mr. Collins?
Yeah, I'd like to propose another motion. And it's back to the issue that I raised in terms of being all-encompassing. And I would say that I would replace the first part, and that it would read that given that Canada has committed $4 billion in military assistance to Ukraine, that the committee receive a comprehensive update on all military support provided to Ukraine, including the NASAMS issue that Mr. Bazan raised today. And that leaves it wide open for us to ask questions about what has not been delivered on and what has been delivered on. Okay, so I put that for the committee's consideration.
Okay. I'm just going to try and get the wording clear here.
Canada has committed $4 billion in military assistance to Ukraine, that the committee receive a comprehensive update on all military support provided to Ukraine, including the NASAM issue. I would just leave it at including NASAM.
And where does that fit in to the substance of the motion? Where do you put that?
It's in the first part.
So then it would read, given that?
It would say, given that, so I'm keeping that.
Yeah.
I would strike in January 2023, and I would keep Canada, and then I would remove the remaining part. And so it would read, given that Canada has committed $4 billion in military assistance to Ukraine, that the committee receive a comprehensive update on all military support provided to Ukraine, including NASAMS.
That's all?
That's it. Leave it at that.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a pretty substantial change.
I would say that it leaves that issue on the table, and it allows us to ask questions on the critique that you heard today is that we haven't delivered to Ukraine. That's the theme of the motion, which coming from where it's coming from is, it, again, it's really hard to listen to. And you can pretend that you're there to support Ukraine, but everything they're doing is in line with what's happening in the United States. We're seeing this conservative alt-right movement in terms of those who seek to undermine Ukraine. And so okay. My motion, Mr. Chair, is beyond just the NASAMS issue.
Mr. Kelly has a point of order.
Well, my point of order is that the motion is not in order. It deletes almost the entire substance of the original motion. It deletes that the committee invite the Minister of Defense. It deletes those words. It deletes the specific concern about the discrepancy between the announcement wherein the minister said that the NASAMS were en route to Ukraine, a demonstrably false statement by that minister on April 11th. So the motion can't gut and remove everything of substance except for the words including NASAMS. So I urge you to find this out of order. It is clearly out of order.
I think you are right.
Mr. Chair,
it is out of order.
I wasn't taking the... Sorry, I don't know if you have a speaker's list, but I wasn't taking the last part out. I was revising the first paragraph there. My intent is to keep the minister...
Okay, so I'm getting contradictory signals. I thought that... you were pretty well deleting everything else in the motion.
No, I deleted within 14 days as part of the second, if you want to call that a paragraph, it's a sentence. And then I said I had a motion on the first paragraph, and I've given you that motion. An amendment.
Yeah, okay. The amendment has to, is the amendment leaving the substance of the motion in place? Yeah. That's the question.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think both the clerk and I misunderstood that. Okay, so.
Can you read what we think
yeah.
before, if we know it's an order or not?
Let us try to read the motion back to you, and I'll call upon my ever so competent clerk to see whether we've got this correct, and then you can decide whether it's in order or it's not in order. As I had understood it, and I think Mr. Kelly understood it, it was not in order.
Sorry, Mr. Collins, do you have a written copy of, like, I would need to see it in order to be able to read it back?
Yeah, I can give you that in a second in terms of, I've scribbled here and then sure. I read it out verbally, so.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, folks. The clerk and the chair are having a minor disagreement here, so we're going to suspend. So. A few minutes left, proposal of Mr. Collins does create difficulties for the chair and the clerk. The given part, given that Canada has committed $4 billion, et cetera, that part is probably in order in that it's not part of the substantive motion. So it could live with the given that is in Mr. Bazan's motion. So the issue then is the committee that Mr. Collins says the committee invite the Minister of National Defense to provide a briefing on the current status of all military support. In my view, changes the substance of Mr. Bazan's motion quite dramatically, so that it's a far more expanded idea than just simply a briefing on NAMs. So in my view, regrettably, I think that is not in order.
Thank you. So with the time left, can we have a vote?
On the motion as amended.
The motion as amended with the 14 days removed. Yeah. Any other debate? Ms. Madison?
In the attempt to maybe come to a place where we could find consensus,
I'll give it a shot.
Now, I don't have the text of what Mr. Collins wrote because it's only been read out. Right? So is there any way to keep quite, to say, yes, there are many things that the government has in fact delivered. Yes, we would like a comprehensive list of what that is. Yes, we would like to talk about all of that with the minister. However, this specifically, and as is laid out by the conservative motion, states that much of it, or this specific thing has not been delivered, And then it would be that the committee invite the minister to provide a briefing on the current status of the NASAMS for Ukraine and all other forms of aid. And then it's a combination of both in the best will we could possibly find.
It's more or less the same thing that Mr. Kelly wants to speak on it.
Yeah. Mr. Kelly.
Right. If you're continuing with debate and not making a specific ruling on that, I'll just simply say that I you would have exactly the same problem with what Ms. Matheson is proposing. It changed the character of the motion entirely.
Yeah, I tend to agree that it broadens the scope out of existence. You can expand the scope a little bit and add, but this goes quite substantively beyond the original motion. So, any other debate? Okay, seeing none, the vote is on the original motion as amended, deleting the 14 days.
Recorded.
Whoa, there's nothing? None of Chad's stuff?
None of Chad's stuff, no.
Okay, recorded, please.
Okay. Go ahead.
Thank you.
So the motion as amended, so the removal of the within 14 days. Mr. Fisher?
Yes.
Mr. Fillmore?
In favor.
Ms. Lambropoulos?
In favor.
Mr. Collins? Ms. Vandenbilt?
In favor.
Mr. Bazan?
In favor.
Ms. Kramp Nyman?
In favor.
Mr. Kelly?
In favor.
Ms. Gallant?
In favor.
Madame Normandin?
Oui.
Ms. Matheson?
Yes.
There you go. 11.
Okay.
11 to 0.
Okay. Don't need to count that. Okay. Well, I do have to get through one thing, and that I need a motion for $3,750 for the study budget of consulting services. Mr. Bazan moved it in a cooperative spirit, I'm sure, and Mr. Collins seconded it also in a cooperative spirit. I thank them for their cooperation. I don't think I need to call for a vote, but I'm assuming everybody is voting in favor of that $3,750 budget. Correct? Okay. Now, the other things that I wanted to get to in an orderly fashion and was not able to is that there's an informal meeting of Ukrainian MPs for the 18th of April at 3:30, and there'll be a notice going out to all of you. So that's in the works. And on May the 10th, the Minister of Defense for Germany, Boris Pistorius, will be here. That's the Friday before the break week. I doubt that many people are going to stay around, but nevertheless, I alert you to that. Do we want to have a meeting with the Minister of Defense for Germany?
What time on Friday?
We haven't set a time for Friday.
He's available Friday morning. And as I say, it's as the chair mentioned, it is the Friday before a break week. So just
Pat.
Well, I hope that I was going to suggest something of minimal formality. You know, just that members that their travel schedules would allow for could attend if they wished, but manage expectations, I think, on the other end.
We got three or four people. We're doing well.
Yes, that would be my suggestion to you.
Yeah. Okay, we'll see what we can do about setting that up, and maybe you could let us know how committed people are. Thirdly, the Latvian delegation. There will be a Latvian delegation here on Wednesday, May 29th. Our suggestion is we devote that our Wednesday meeting to the Latvian delegation.
Part of it, anyway.
At least part of it, yeah. Cheryl? Okay.
So it's great they're coming, and we can meet with them. But we've had so many of our meetings hijacked already by other situations. Is it possible that we could have a luncheon meeting on that day so that we're not taking away from our current work?
We could look into it.
I could look into it.
Yeah. It's always getting rooms and translation and rooms. That's the issue.
Yeah.
So
I could look into it.
We'll look into it. We'll check. And Monday, Minister Blair will